Good afternoon, this is Sean Golding with Golding & Golding, here to discuss the basics of foreign pension income and U.S. tax. Let's start by going through what types of individuals may be subject to foreign pension income tax-related issues in the U.S. It's generally going to be what's called U.S. persons. And when that involves individuals, it's generally going to be a U.S. citizen, either by birth or naturalization, a legal permanent resident, aka green card holder, or visa holder or foreign national with substantial presence. So there's a third catch-all category which says, look, even if you're not a resident or a citizen, if you've been living in the U.S. long enough over the last 3 years using a 1-to-1, 3-to-1, 6-to-1 ratio, then at the end of the day, you may be subject to U.S. tax on that income. Worldwide income, excuse me. So there are some general rules regarding foreign pension, and it goes like this. In the U.S., for example, you have a 401k. With a 401k, contributions are normally tax-free. Then one day you retire, you get those distributions, and the goal is that the tax rate at the time you retire will be less than the tax rate at the time you contributed the income, so you're getting that benefit, and hopefully it grew over time, and you come out ahead. The U.S. doesn't really follow that same rule as for foreign pensions, unless there's like a specific something written into the treaty. So if there's a bilateral income tax treaty with like the UK, right, that has a very healthy treaty on pension, retirement, social security related issues, generally the US is going to tax that income when it's being contributed. This is very common for our clients with provident funds. So looking at like a CPF in Singapore, the IRS issued a memoranda or a letter more specifically back in 96 or 97, said the contributions are taxable. So let me give you an example. Let's say Joe has $100,000 income. He's a U.S. person, but he's also a permanent resident in Singapore. He's earning salary over there. They're contributing money into his CPF. What was contributed into his CPF may gain tax benefits at the time it's contributed in Singapore. The U.S. doesn't recognize those benefits. So Joe is still going to get taxed on $100,000. If, let's say, 10 of it was contributed, he's still going to get taxed on $100,000. Now, let's say Jane is earning $100,000 in the UK. If she qualifies under the treaty, and quick side issue, there's no treaty with Singapore on bilateral income tax treaty, and so that's why the negative impact on the US tax. With the UK, for example, when Jane earns $100,000 and $10,000 is going into her UK retirement, well, as long as it meets certain requirements of the treaty, I believe it's Article 17 or 18, then guess what? She gets the same tax waiver on the money that's being contributed. So it's equivalent to the 401k, and it's up to whatever she would be allowed in the U.S. for contributions into her 401k in the U.S. So it's a great benefit for the treaty. Growth, same concept, right? Going back to Joe and Jane, Joe's CPF in Singapore, let's say it earns $3,000 a year in interest and dividends. He doesn't touch that money. He can't touch that money while it grows in Singapore. Guess what? From a U.S. tax perspective, that growth is also taxable. Conversely, Jane in the U.K., the $3,000 that's growing within hers is generally going to be non-taxable. Now, it's important to distinguish between a pension plan and something someone uses as pension or kind of mentally conceptually. So like in India, there's an EPF for employees. That's probably going to escape tax during the growth, whereas a PPF, public provident fund, may be used for the same purpose by the taxpayer, but it's going to be taxable, the growth. Just like an ISA in the UK, depending on the PFIC status, you're not going to receive that same tax deferred treatment necessarily that you would for a UK pension. Now, when you have tax-free distributions in foreign countries, you have to look at the treaty to see whether you get that same sort of treaty protection in the United States. And if there is a treaty position that the taxpayer wants to take, they can submit what's called a Form 8833 tax treaty position with their tax return identifying what portion of the treaty they're relying on and the basis for it. Now, the 8833 is not required for all tax treaty positions, but there are several of them. It's definitely important to go through the 8833 before submitting because the instructions have a list of what has to be included, what doesn't have to be included. So there's no point in paying someone to complete a full 8833 if it's not required. There's also reporting requirements for pensions, but we have a separate presentation for that, FBAR and FATCA and things like that. That doesn't really impact the tax. This focuses on the tax. But if you have unreported pension income, reporting on FBAR, FATCA for prior years, there are various ways you can get into compliance. One common misconception is that if a foreign institution that holds pensions does not have to report maybe under the FATCA agreement, that doesn't mean that the individual who is a US person escapes the reporting. They generally have to report their foreign pension on FBAR, FATCA Form 8938. Some people used to do it on 3520A as an apple as well. We always thought it was sort of like duplicate reporting because it just, that's not really what it seemed like they meant. And so in 2020, what's nice is the IRS issued a revenue procedure, RevProc, they call it 2020-17, which basically says that, hey, you don't have to do the duplicate reporting. But in any event, if you need to get into compliance for some of these issues, there's various tax amnesty, or what that is referred to as offshore voluntary disclosure programs. There's the traditional voluntary disclosure, which took over where OVDP left off. Traditional voluntary disclosures have been around forever. OVDP was an offshoot of that program specifically for offshore related issues. Traditional was used just for domestic most of the time. They got rid of OVDP in 2018, but they also expanded the traditional voluntary disclosure. So if you cannot certify under penalty of perjury that you are non-willful, traditional voluntary disclosure would be the option for you. For people who are non-willful, there are the streamlined filing compliance procedures. There's the domestic version and the foreign version. They both refer to offshore assets, accounts, investments, and income, but you can also tack on any domestic related issues. The difference is foreign is for foreign residents, domestic is for non-foreign residents. There is also reasonable cause to avoid penalties or to abate it after the fact, if that's the position you're in. And then there are the various delinquency procedures, delinquent international information return submission procedures, and delinquent FBAR submission procedures. I hope this was helpful. Again, my name is Sean Golding with Golding & Golding. Thank you for your time. Enjoy the rest of your day.